bulls have compassed me. Strong bulls of Bashan have beset me round. They gaped upon me with as a rave. I am poured out like water, and all my bones are out of joint. My heart is like wax. It melted in the midst of my bowels. My strength is dried up like a potsherd, and my tongue cleaveth to my jaws. And thou hast brought me into the dust of death. For dogs have compassed me. The assembly of the wicked have enclosed me. They pierced my hands and my feet. I may tell all my bones. They look and stare upon me. They part my garments among them and cast lots upon my vesture. But be not thou far from me, O Lord. O my strength, haste thee to help me. Deliver my soul from the sword, my darling from the power of the dog. Save me from the lion's mouth, for thou hast heard me from the horns of the unicorns. I will declare thy name unto my brethren. In the midst of the congregation I will praise thee. Ye that fear the Lord, praise him. All ye the seed of Jacob, glorify him, and fear him, all ye the seed of Israel. For he hath not despised nor abhorred the affliction of the afflicted, neither hath he hid his face from him. But when he cried unto him, he heard. My praise shall be of thee in the great congregation. I will pay my vows before them that fear him. The meek shall eat and be satisfied. They shall praise the Lord that seek him. Your heart shall live forever. All the ends of the world shall remember and turn unto the Lord, and all the kindreds of the nations shall worship before thee. For the kingdom is the Lord's, and he is the governor among the nations. All they that be fat upon earth shall eat and worship. All they that go down to the dust shall bow before him, and none can keep alive his own soul. Seed shall serve him. It shall be accounted to the Lord for a generation. They shall come and shall declare his righteousness unto a people. It shall be born that he hath done this. Father, we pray tonight that as we open your word, that you would open our hearts, that we could hear you speak to us. Holy Spirit, we pray that you would bring us into a deeper, agonized psalm. Before and after taking the throne of Israel, David lived in seasons of great danger, seasons of deprivation. Matthew Poole, who wrote a commentary in the 1600s, I believe, said this, quote, "I doubt not that David, though he had an eye to his own condition in various passages here used, yet was carried forth by the spirit of prophecy beyond himself and unto Christ, to whom alone it truly and fully agreed." And that is exactly what we read here. The word Ejaleth there to the chief musician actually means help. It's an appeal for help. And you have King David, and you have King Jesus. And what we are reading and listening to is David, the prophet, not only speaking of his own experiences, but seeing beyond those experiences the Messiah, Jesus Christ. The four Psalms of suffering, also called the Passion Psalms, are Psalm 16, Psalm 22, Psalm 40, and Psalm 69, and they address for us the deep distress that was experienced by Jesus Christ. And this chapter, like so many chapters, prophetic chapters, gives us another example of the divine inspiration of Scripture. Because 1,000 years before the crucifixion, David foresaw by the Spirit the suffering of the crucified Messiah. Psalm 22 has been appropriately labeled the crucifixion psalm, or the psalm of the cross. And the citation of verse 1 by our Savior on the cross, and the quotation of verse 18 by John in chapter 19, verse 24, and of verse 22 by the author of Hebrews is fulfilled in Christ, clearly indicates that the New Testament writers understood that David was speaking of someone far more than himself. The psalm is actually divided into two sections: the lament in verses 1 through 21, and praise for redemption, verses 22 through 31, which naturally will lead to Psalm 23. Not next week. Next week is our prayer night, and I'd love to see this place packed to the max for prayer night, unless you don't need prayer. My God, why have you forsaken me? That was the cry of Jesus from the cross. We read the words, Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani. And Jesus here, experiencing great pain and suffering, and he's agonizing from the cross, he quotes Psalm 22. And verse 1 are some of the most intense and mysterious descriptions of what Jesus experienced on the cross. My God, he's speaking, of course, as Son of Man. As Son of God, he's equal to the Father. As Son of Man, the Father had forsaken the Lord in those moments. But what was the reason? The reason was because he was made sin. Him who knew no sin was made to be sin for us. And Jesus not only endured the withdrawal of the Father's fellowship, but he also experienced the actual outpouring of the Father's wrath upon him as a substitute for our sin. God turned his back on the sin that he hated, not the son that he loved. My God, why have you forsaken me? Even though Jesus himself was without sin, he literally took on himself all at once the full impact of judgment for humanity's rebellion against us. Galatians tells us that on the cross he became a curse for us. My God, why have you forsaken me? Let me ask you, church family, have you ever felt forsaken or abandoned by God? For those who repent and receive Christ's sacrifice for their sins, we may have felt that way, but we can rest assured that because of what Jesus endured, we have the promise, "Lo, I'm with you always, even unto the end of the world." He says, the Bible says in Hebrews 13, verse 5, "I will never leave you nor forsake you." And in the Greek, it's so emphasized, "I will never, 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 never leave you nor forsake you." And there are times we feel forsaken. But let's set the record straight. We might feel that way, but we're not. And when you're feeling forsaken, remember the truth of God. Because the only weapon that the devil has is a lie, and he's empowered when we believe it. In fact, I believe that sometimes the Lord is probably closest to us when we are hurting the most. And here's the Son of Man crying out my God, why have you forsaken me? Why are you so far from helping me and from the words of my roaring? The same verb is used in verse 13 of that of a roaring lion. It's hard to imagine what Christ endured. It's unimaginable. One commentator says, from a diaphragm sagging in pain and a heart filled with sorrow, Christ inquired of the incomprehensibility of the solitude on the cross. Oh my God, he says in verse 2, I cry in the daytime, but thou hearest not, and in the night season, and am not silent. There seemed to be no explanation for the lack of God's help, and that's why the question was, why? Why? But whether David did not know of his present situation, certainly Jesus did. I like how in verse 3, they fell back on what they did know, but you are holy. From why to, but you are holy. But you are holy. God is holy. He's ultimately holy. You are holy that inhabits the praises of Israel. There were things that David, and there were things that Christ was experiencing that were beyond, I can't even think, as far as Jesus is concerned. I can think of David beyond knowledge. Jesus is just, he's on the cross. Why? But then he goes back. But God, Father, you're holy. And you inhabit the praises of Israel. When you and I pour out our hearts to the Lord, not just in the context of what we were just doing, God inhabits those praises. He inhabits those praises. He's enthroned upon those praises. When you and I praise our God, there's a heightened awareness of his presence. And it's beyond, although it's not excluding a worship service, I can recall on one of my trips to Israel, we were at the Jerusalem Hilton. And it was filled with, of course, it's filled with Orthodox Jews. And there was a couple of buses of people from various churches. And in the main lobby, there was this Jewish man playing piano. And one of the men on the trip was a jazz pianist. And this jazz pianist struck up a conversation with this Jewish guy who was playing piano. And Eddie said, hey, would you mind if I sat in for you when you were on the break? And the guy says, sure, go ahead. Go ahead. You know? And so he begins to play. And then he begins to play the song. Lizzie, help me. What was it? It was from Joel. Let the weak say my song. What is it? Give thanks. So there was this African-American sister there. She just started singing. There we were in the middle of Jerusalem. She started singing, and she started worshiping God, and the Spirit of God came upon that place in such a mighty way, and she was just singing to the Lord. No smoke machine. No overheads. She was just praising the Lord, and it was one of the most memorable moments of my trips there. He inhabits your praises in the car, in the shower. He inhabits your praises. Verse 4, our fathers trusted in thee. They trusted, and you did deliver them. They cried unto thee and were delivered. They trusted in thee and were not confounded or put to shame. David, no doubt, was thinking of the time that Abraham was delivered from the five kings in Genesis 14. When Joseph was delivered from the Egyptian prison there in Genesis chapter 41. Most of all, Moses and Israel from the land of Egypt. And then here is now is Jesus. But I am a worm and no man. a worm. An image of lowliness and worthlessness. Charles Spurgeon says, quote, "This verse is a miracle in language. How could the Lord of glory be brought to such abasement as to be not only lower than the angels, but even lower than men? What a contrast between I am and I am a worm. I'm a worm." A reproach of men and despised of the people. Hard to believe that our precious Lord was disgraced, that he was treated with contempt. Isaiah said that he was despised, he was rejected of men. He was a man of sorrows, he was acquainted with grief. Beloved, when you and I are going through times of sorrow and grief, never think that Jesus can't relate to you. Never think that. So despised was our Lord that they desired to have a murderer released instead of the Lord of glory. Glimpses of the cross. All they that see me laugh me to scorn. They shoot out the lip that speaks of how they open their mouths in a gesture of derision. Temple and builds it in 3 days. Save yourself. Come down from the cross. But he went to the cross to save us. And Jesus would say of these people that were wagging their heads and mocking him and scorning him, he would say, "Father, forgive them. They don't know what they're doing." Imagine. Incredible. They shake the head. They shoot out the lip. They laugh me to scorn. He trusted. That word trusted is a Hebrew word that means how Christ rolled his way upon the Lord. He now is as the Son of Man. He's fully surrendering all his entire being to why he came. Remember, he was the Lamb of God slain from the foundation of the world. Say, "Into thy hands I commit my spirit." He trusted on the Lord that he would deliver him. And let him deliver him, seeing he delighted in him. Isn't it interesting? Matthew 27:43 records that this text was cited by the scribes and the elders as they witnessed the crucifixion of the Lord Jesus. And then Jesus so affectionately says, "But you are he that took me out of the womb. You did make me hope when I was upon my mother's breasts. I was cast upon thee from the womb. You are my God from my mother's belly." The incarnation. "I was in your hands even before my birth. You're my God from the time that I was in my mother's body." He cries out, "Be not far from me, for trouble is near. Isaiah said in chapter 52, verse 14, many were astonished at thee. His visage was so marred more than any man, and his form more than the sons of men. As you look up at the cross, is that a man up there? Marred, bones out of joint, poured out like water. The pain, unimaginable. The physical pain, mental pain, emotional pain, unimaginable. My heart is like wax. There are some medical descriptions of the cross that say when Christ died, he died of a broken heart. The intense pain and suffering of the cross is matched only by the intense pain of bearing the sins of mankind. My heart is like wax. My strength is dried up like a potsherd. Remember, they would try to offer him something to drink. Potsherd, a piece of broken pottery. My tongue cleaves to my jaws, the terrible thirst, and you have brought me to the point or to the dust of death. John's Gospel, chapter 19, says, Jesus, knowing that all things were now accomplished, that the scripture might be fulfilled, said, I thirst. For dogs have compassed me. The assembly of the wicked have enclosed me. They pierced my hands. If there thus far had been any doubt that this psalm refers directly to the Messiah, Jesus Christ, all doubt is swept away. They pierced my hands and my feet. Just the scourging of Jesus physically was unimaginable. The leather scourge with sharp pieces of metal and glass. They whipped our Lord's back. Veins broken, flesh unimaginable. You see, and they would interrogate the one that was being whipped. They would ask for the reason for the crime. There was no reason. There was no sin. What did you do? Nothing. Silence. What did you do? More intense. All that for you. All that for me. All that for us. They pierced my hands and my feet. The prophet Zechariah, speaking of this, says in chapter 12, verse 10, I will pour upon the house of David and upon the inhabitants of Jerusalem the spirit of grace and of supplications. They shall look upon me whom they have pierced, and they shall mourn for him as one mourneth for his only son, and shall be in bitterness for him as one that is in bitterness for his firstborn. When Christ comes back the second time with his bride, the church, the Jews will realize, we did this. The use of the phrase, I will pour upon the inhabitants of Jerusalem the spirit of grace and of supplications, it depicts the sorrow that will follow the realization of the Jews that they actually killed the Messiah. And yet, he returns the second time to defend them from their adversaries. Don't forget, when you read the prophecies of the end times, words, the prophecy surrounding the second coming, there's a clear, clear picture. It's all of the nations of the world against the Jews. That's it. There's no mention of the church because we're not going to be on earth for that great tribulation period. It's all nations against the Jews. Jesus comes back the second time. Imagine. Sword going out of his mouth. You. It's you. John the Revelator says, "Behold, he comes with clouds, and every eye shall see him, and they also which pierced him, and all the kindreds of the earth shall wail because of him, even so. Amen." He's coming a second time, without sin unto salvation. He's coming back a second time. Every eye is going to see him. People ask how. Sometimes we ask the dumbest questions. You can be on another part of the world and have access to the internet and watch or listen to a television program on another part of the world. And they're saying, how is he going to do that? Well, I don't know how, but I know it's going to happen. Just like every eye is going to see him. And those that reject him are going to wail. They'll see him. They're going to see him. All the kindreds of the earth are going to wail because of him. The kings, the rich men, the high and mighty are going to say to the rocks and to the mountains, fall on us. Hide us from the wrath of the Lamb. There is a wrath that is going to be poured out upon this planet. But Christ bore the wrath that you and I deserve. We'll never taste the wrath of God. Never. Christ tasted it for us. Verse 27. I may tell all my bones, they look and stare upon me. Literally, this can be translated this way. I can count all my bones, and my enemies just stare and sneer at me. Can you imagine that? And I personally believe that at any moment of time, Jesus could have said, Father, that's it. He could have called 12 legions of angels. He said, that's it. So emaciated was Jesus, and so distended was his body from the posture on the cross that it was possible to count the bones of his body. They parted my garments among them and cast lots upon my vesture. Is gambling biblical? Yeah, they were doing it at the foot of the cross. That's the kind of crowd I want to hang with. Parting garments, casting lots, a typical means by which the soldiers would divide the spoils of victory. And the Roman soldiers did just that. And they did not have in their back pocket, if I may use the term, Psalm 22. How many of these things happened just like God said they would happen? No script. This isn't a play. This is real life. And whatever God says is going to take place is going to take place just like he said it. There are some people that want to diminish or minimize the book of Revelation and some of the horrific, graphic scenes that we read of the second coming in the minor and major prophets. But Jesus said, or the word of God says, don't add to his word and don't take away. When God says there's going to be demons coming out of the pit of hell and tormenting people on earth for 5 months, don't let anybody tell you that those are pictures of evil. No, that's what's going to happen. All of the things you read about in the book of Revelation, they're going to happen. It may be apocalyptic literature or apocalyptic language, but it's going to happen just as literally as every other judgment took place. That wasn't a fictitious flood. Those weren't imaginary plagues in Egypt. Every one of the four Gospels recorded. Every one of them. Verse 19, but be not thou far from me, O Lord, O my strength, hasty to help me, deliver my soul from the sword. It may well be a reference to the authority of the Roman governor. My darling from the power of the tongue, save me from the lion's mouth, for thou hast heard me from the horns of the unicorns. As horrible as the crucifixion was, it was the only way by which God's good and loving plan of redemption for you and me could be fulfilled. Isaiah 53, 10 and 11 says, yet it pleased the Lord to bruise him. He has put him to grief. When you shall make his soul an offering for sin, he shall see his seed. He shall prolong his days, and the pleasure of the Lord shall prosper in his hand. He shall see the travail of his soul and shall be satisfied. By his knowledge shall my righteous servant justify many, for he shall bear their iniquities. He bore all of our iniquities, past, present, and future. Amazing grace. He bore them all. He did. That's how our sins are forgiven, because Christ bore the punishment. He paid the price to redeem us. And now, verse 22, the triumph. I will declare thy name unto my brethren. In the midst of the congregation will I praise thee. Hebrews 2:12 says, I will declare thy name unto my brethren, and in the midst of the church will I sing praise unto thee. I wonder what kind of a voice Jesus had. Imagine him singing in the temple, singing in the synagogue. I personally believe that he probably sang off key. There was somebody standing next to him, go, come on, will you get it together there, guy? Sing on key. Clap on beat or something. And Hebrews 2:12 marks how Jesus triumphed over sin by his death on the cross. He's now the exalted Redeemer. He's now the one who rescues and liberates those who trust him from the eternal results of sin. And it's through him that we are brought into a relationship with God. And the task of crucifixion and atonement complete, as soon as Jesus said it is finished, it was all. There will never be a repetition of Calvary. He did it all then. Right then, he paid the debt. All of it. All of it. Your debt. My debt. He paid it all. And Jesus says, I will declare your name to my brethren. You that fear the Lord, praise him. All you, the seed of Jacob, glorify him and fear him, all ye, the seed of Israel. When you fear the Lord, you're going to praise him. Fearing God doesn't mean you're afraid of him. You reverence him. You hold him in awe. I think one of the things that the body of Christ, this body, needs is a new awareness of what it means to fear God. How we need a revelation of fearing God. It's the beginning of wisdom. It's the beginning of knowledge. It's the path of holiness. You that fear the Lord, praise him. Praise him. Glorify him. For he has not despised nor abhorred the affliction of the afflicted, neither has he hid his face from him. But when he cried unto him, he heard. He's not unmoved by your pain or by your trouble. He doesn't hide his face from you. That's what he says. He doesn't despise that. He doesn't abhor that when you're afflicted. He doesn't hide his face from you. One writer said this: the seeming passivity of God during the ordeal of the cross was only that, seeming passivity. Seeming. He hears you when you cry. You know that? We all wonder, well, why don't you just put on your super messiah cape and come and get me out of here? Right? It doesn't happen that way. The Bible talks about the sufferings of this present life, how they're not worthy to be compared with the glory that's going to be revealed in us. We all suffer. We all have difficulties. We all have things that happen in our lives that we simply can't understand. But there's a lot in the Bible that we don't understand. By faith, we understand. By faith, we believe. By faith, we embrace the promises of God. It's easy when things are going well, isn't it? Oh boy, I can walk on water, it seems like, when things are going well. One nasty email, and that's it. One little headache, and that's it. And then you watch the news, and they have all of the programs now for the people. You know, if you have a pain in your knee, if you have a twitch in your neck, if you have, they've already got you in the ambulance and going to the hospital, you know. The Lord, Emmanuel, God with us. How we need to cultivate the reality of that. It's one thing to know the verses. It's another thing to believe them. The Apostle John says, we have known and believed the love that God has for us. It's amazing how you and I can have good theology in our minds and in our lips, but be void of the encounter with the Lord. The Lord here is showing us how much he loves us. The Father is showing us here how much he loves us. And we live in a fallen world that's been wracked by sin. But we are strangers. We are pilgrims. We are headed for a world, for a universe that is unlike anything that we've ever seen here. Unlike it. The best is yet to come. My praise, verse 25, shall be of thee in the great congregation. I will pay my vows before them that fear him. The meek shall eat and be satisfied. Satisfied, finally, when we get to glory. Finally, satisfied. Finally. You know, nothing temporal is ever going to satisfy us. Nothing. Nothing. There is a day when we will be satisfied. David said, I will be satisfied when I awake with your likeness. heart shall live forever. All the ends of the earth shall remember and turn to the Lord, and all the kindreds of the nations shall worship before thee. Oh, what a glorious, glorious day that's going to be. And here, David is looking to the whole world as a mission field. And the Lord Jesus envisions countless Gentiles turning unto him for salvation. And he uses the likes of you and me to be instruments, vehicles, through whom the lost are brought into the kingdom. For the kingdom is the Lord's, and he is the governor among the nations. Verse 28, I love that verse. The kingdom is the Lord's. He rules. He reigns. Tonight, he rules and he reigns. All of the confusion, all of the chaos, the political chaos, the violence, the racism, all of the nonsense that is going on. But the Lord sits enthroned. And here's the thing. All of that's going on in the world. God forbid that should not be taking place in the body of Christ. You know, in grace, there is no race, right? There is no race. There's no, you know, there's no big shots and little shots. And there's no caste system. There's one head, one Savior, one King, one Lord, and then there's the rest of us. That's it. The kingdom is the Lord's. He's the governor among the nations. Oh, Lord, Jesus taught us to pray, thy kingdom come, thy will be done. And one day that prayer is going to be answered. All they that be fed upon the earth shall eat and worship. So don't believe all of the Nutrisystem things that they tell you. I've lost 50 pounds in 20 days. Well, good for you. Okay, I mean that. Good for you. You know, it's like you're still going to die. So you'll be the best looking thin man in a coffin. Are you born again? See, that's it. We have eternal life. You and I have eternal life. All they that be fed upon the earth shall eat and worship. In the Bible, fat is where it's at. The Bible says, delight yourself in fatness. Amen. Yes. No, all kidding aside. There is a day when the church, the body, the Jews, the Gentiles, all races, all kindreds, all tongues are going to be gathered together before him and worshiping him. Do you ever wonder what kind of music they're going to play? Boy, don't you just long for that day? I mean, I think of my mom and my dad and my mother-in-law and father-in-law, when they breathe their last breath on earth, what they step into, you know? And I have to admit, part of me goes, I'm so jealous. I'm so jealous. All they that be fed upon the earth shall eat and worship. All they that go down to the dust shall bow before him. None can keep alive his own soul. Bible says, at the name of Jesus, every knee shall bow, of things in heaven, things in earth, and things under the earth, and every tongue shall confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father, every tongue. Those people that are telling you, I don't believe in God, one day you're going to be declaring Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. You see, what keeps us stable, beloved, what keeps us consistent is by keeping our eyes in the cross. You get your eyes off of the cross. You get your eyes off of Jesus. You get your eyes on individuals in the body of Christ. I don't care who they are, and they may let you down. We're hearing a whole bunch of stuff recently about people that have forsaken their faith and how that affects other people. My security, our security is in Christ. He conquered. He paid the price. He died on the cross. He rose again from the dead. He's seated at the right hand of the Father. And you know that deep in your gut. You know, yes, yes, yes. Yes, we fail. Yes, we're flawed. But it's Christ that we look to. He's the one that keeps us consistent. Every tongue will confess that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of God the Father. A seed shall serve him. It shall be accounted for a generation. We've been redeemed to be servants, not superstars. Been redeemed to be servants. There's no professional way that you can serve the Lord. How do you professionally mourn? How do you professionally do Sunday school? How do you professionally repent? You know, we've so turned, unfortunately, the beauty of the body of Christ into some machine. We're servants. There's no higher calling on earth. Imagine this. Joe, the Lord walks into your bedroom. Just imagine walking into your room. Joe, I want you to go to every house in the neighborhood, and I want you to empty out the trash of everyone in the neighborhood for me. Sure, Lord. Watch, I'll even clean the bin. You want to be great in the kingdom of God? Learn to be a servant of all. You know what one of my prayers for this church family is that we would have servant wars. Agape servant wars. Yes. We have a need with the children. I'm going to go. No! I'm going. We have a need here. No, I'm going to go. No. Erased her name off the list. I'm putting it on. Wouldn't it be great? Wouldn't it be just absolutely fabulous? Yes, Lord. Yeah. Servants of the King. Servants of the King. They shall come, last verse, and shall declare his righteousness unto a people that shall be born. Us. Tonight. For he has done this. In other words, the good news of the cross is going to be proclaimed. They declared it here 1,000 years before it took place. It took place, and it is being declared now until Christ returns the second time. Generation after generation are going to see those come to Christ through the grace of God. And as we close tonight, I pray that the message of the crucifixion will never grow old. Never, never. As the worship team comes up with this final song, Apostle John writes this, and this was manifested, the love of God toward us, because that God sent his only begotten Son into the world that we might live through him. Herein is love, not that we loved God, but that he loved us, and sent his Son to be the propitiation for our sins. Beloved, if God so loved us, we ought also love one another. God, perfectly holy, sinless, loved me. Perfectly unholy and so full of sin. If God so loved me, then who am I to say I can't love you? Or I won't. In fact, you know, we're commanded. commanded to love one another. Jesus doesn't suggest it. By this shall all men know that you are my disciples if you speak in tongues. By this shall all men know that you are my disciples if you have a love for one another. We're going to talk about this, Lord willing, on Sunday morning. That's it. Christ died for sinners. Sinners who repent become his body. That's us. And the Bible tells us that the love that God has showed us through Christ is a love that we are to give to one another. That's radical. That's radical. That's challenging. That challenges my flesh to the core. But it's the Spirit of God who dwells in you and in me. John, the apostle, probably about 93 years old, here writing about the same time that he's writing the Revelation, and he talks about the cross and what God has done for us. And when we dwell with a knowledge of the cross, there's going to be a love that we have for one another that's going to be pure, that's going to be holy, that's going to be the reason why we do what we do. It's going to motivate us to do everything. God commands us to love one another. And we have known and believed the love that God has to us. God is love. He that dwells in love dwells in God, and God in him. And why do we love him? Because he first loved us. Amen. And where was that most gloriously manifested? There on Mount Calvary. Let's stand, please. Our gracious Father, tonight we stand in awe of the record of Scripture. And I know that I've spoke for a while, Lord, but this passage, like every other atonement passage, leaves us speechless. Forgive me, Lord, for the times where I've doubted your love. I've questioned your love because of something going on in me or around me. Lord, I pray that tonight you would once again just reveal to each and every person here tonight the reality of the love that you have for us. And the reality of the promise that you will never leave us, that you will never forsake us. And I pray that we would be obedient as a church family, Lord, to heed that command of loving one another. And not just those within these four walls, but those who call Christ as Lord. Father, thank you that everything that you have prophesied will come to pass. Heaven and earth will pass away, but your words will never pass away. Use us to be instruments of your love and of your grace and of your mercy, not only to one another in the body of Christ, but in a world that is lost and hurting and confused and angry. Lord, help us. Help us by your Spirit to make a difference in our sphere of influence. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Thank you.
suffering sea, and faced with all your glory, we meet, Prince of Peace. But Jesus, in that moment, when every trial has passed, oh, we'll need you still, we'll need you, living God. No other God but you, no other God but you, no other God can satisfy. You are our great reward, it's you.
Worship you and follow you, God. And truly, Lord, seek no other. Know that you are our God and our Savior, and you love us. We thank you and praise you. In your name we pray. Amen. Amen. God bless you.
got it? 1, 2, 1, 2. 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2. 1, 2, 1, 2. Test 1, 2. Test 1, 2. 1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2, 3, 4. Test 1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2, 3, 4. Test, 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 test. Test, 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 test. 1, 2, 3, 4. I'm running out of things to say. Hello, hello, hello. Test, test, test. 1, 2, 3, 4. Carm's doing something in there, and he needs somebody to talk into the mic. 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2, 3, 4. Test, test, test. 1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2, 3, 4.